Good afternoon, good morning, and good evening to everyone. Hopefully you can all see the slide deck that I'm sharing. You are attending the Remote Attestations Procedures Working Group, virtual interim meeting. And this is an official meeting, so the note well applies. I want to spend a couple of minutes going through the agenda bash as we've been making updates myself up until last night. So first order of business, I need at least one person, if not two, to take notes on the Etherpad. Can I have at least one volunteer, please? Because we cannot move forward until we have that.
I can do it. This is Ned.
Oh, thanks, Ned. All right. So usurping some of the minutes while we wait for people to go on, I wanted to have the agenda bash. Then there was a joint hackathon between Teep, Rats, and Suit in Germany back in February. So I asked Hannes to provide a report on that. Michael, you said you could finish the update on the architecture design team. I gave you 10 minutes just in case. I gave the other 10 minutes to Lawrence so that you could get what you need. Although I think it's fine for you to just do the merge. The chairs can go through the issues from the poll request and close them, if you will, but you can discuss that. Gary, you asked for 15 minutes to talk about unendorsed tokens. And Eric, you had asked for some time, and I mentioned if time elapsed, you could discuss the new draft that was posted. Any comments or issues with the agenda? Now's the time to set up.
Good.
Looks good. All right. Good. That said, Hannes, did you want me to project the slides, or do you?
That would be great. Yep.
Okay. 1 second. All right. Can you guys see the slides? I can put it in presentation mode.
Someone is typing here. Okay. I only have 5 minutes. So I briefly want to give a summary of the hackathon, which we called Securing the IoT. And it took place in February, and some of the folks on the call were actually part of that event. Next slide. So we were lucky that Matthias Welisch, who works as a professor at the Freie Universität Berlin, sort of hosted the event and provided us with meeting facilities. And you can see the place, the meeting rooms that we used, quite a nice location to spread out and to sort of gather in different groups. We got some hardware from Nordic Semiconductors, which were mostly used by the Suit group, not by the other groups. And I'm sponsored some money for the social event and food and so on. We had 45 registered participants, and about 40 showed up. And we tried to cover 3 different topics, which are, as you know, related: RAT, Suit, and Deep. And there's the link to the the hackathon website, which also includes the slides and some information about the code that we have been using. So it's probably useful to take a look at that. Next slide. So this is a picture I took when the RATS group was busily working on some of their stuff. I used that opportunity. Next slide. And here are a few impressions that I collected from the folks. We started off with a tutorial day, and I thought it was useful, but obviously I'm interested to hear feedback from those who attended the event. It's obviously difficult to find the right level, but the slides, as I said, are available, so you can look at them. What you obviously can't see is some of the hands-on things that people showed, like Dave Taylor. So it's really a sort of on-site tutorial.
So was it, Hannes, was it a tutorial on all three?
Yes, yeah. So we tried to, it was actually, in that sense, it was quite compressed because the challenge is, and I think this would be a challenge also in the future, is that you have a mixture of people. Some of the participants were extremely familiar with the technology, so you don't need to explain them anything because they have been hacking around in that space already for years. And then others who are less experienced and they need a little bit of extra help. We distributed some of the links to the development environment, to the code, et cetera, upfront, but it's still a challenge. In this case,
tutorial day that covered all three, but there were separate tutorials for each of the three.
Right.
But going in sequence, not parallel.
In sequence, yeah.
Yeah. No, so I think that's useful.
Well, I should send a survey around and ask people for their views. That only came to my mind when I wrote the slide. So what I was told was the fact that we had a hackathon actually was very useful because people looked at the code, tried to make it update the documentation, tried to update the code to get it ready so that people actually work with something that with a good foundation. And so that was useful. And the fact that we had an event like this allowed some of the people to actually meet each other. I didn't realize that some folks actually haven't seen each other before. So that was good, not just IDF people, but also other people. And during the event, we found a couple of bugs. We noticed what was difficult to understand. So you only find that out when you actually try things. And clearly, like I'm not downplaying the difficulty of some of those topics. It's difficult to make progress on such complicated topics in 2 days, which is essentially the time you have if you're not already familiar with the topic. So we had a few people who kind of dropped out. That's why we had fewer people on the last day, for example. And in the RATS group in particular, people worked on getting this the trusted firmware M with the PSA Crypt API, working on this LPC board that we used. Hank and others and Michael worked on a deep EM based attestation. Lawrence helped others with understanding the CBOR, the QC board, DCOSI and C token code and updated the code. And Hank and colleagues worked on, if I pronounce that correctly, Kara, to use QCBOR and DCOSI, and some of the code has been uploaded already. And yeah, we need to collect all the code in general, not just for RATS. We are looking at the sort of, in general, people thought hackathons and these type of events were really useful. And so we are figuring out on whether we can do another one of those, maybe in the US. And some of the guys have actually indicated they want to sort of collaborate on or continue working on the code in between the hackathons and try to sort of just advance things as we are between the IDF meetings and between the hackathons. I think overall quite positive. And I don't know if someone on the call has some additional comments.
I think it would be good to take this up on the mail list, Hannes.
Yep.
Start the discussion. One, because you're out of time. And two, I think there's use and value to this. And to your earlier point, I think it makes good sense if you set the goals up front for the hackathon so that people who attend don't get caught by surprise with respect to expectations.
Yeah, I think we did. We tried to provide that and send emails to folks up front. But and I think in general we had we were lucky, actually. We had a lot of very experienced people, so that was good. But it could very well be different if you suddenly have half of the room is unfamiliar with the technology, then you are pretty much toast.
Yeah. Okay, my machine is locking up. All right. Thank you, Hannes. Michael, you are next.
Okay, let me project. You see that?
Yes.
Is that projecting? Okay. And I'll just add to end Hannes's comment off, there's a lot of logistics for the hackathon. And the primary reason to do it again is to leverage all those logistics that you've already done. So I'm enthusiastic about doing it more. The RATS architecture design team continued to meet, although we hummed and hawed about whether we were going to meet during the hackathon. In the end, we kind of canceled at last minute because we were all kind of heads down, really focused on other stuff. And also the internet was not so good at the hackathon. So that's a thing itself. So we've had three more meetings since we last talked. I guess we've opened about 10 new issues and closed a whole bunch on that since there. Pull requests, we've created four new ones and created six new ones and have two still open. We've made a fair bit of progress on the document. I can post that URL into the chat. That's the diff. There's not a huge amount of visible diffs at this point. In fact, looking at it, it seems a little bit depressing because we've mostly, in some cases, had half-hour arguments over a single word change in the document. But I guess better our group than the working group as a whole. There are six use cases now included. We had basically most of a meeting discussing whether or not this was a tester or a composite device. And there were changes to the diagram that resulted in back and forth and many other small wording nits that were done as well. What else to say about that? We still have an introduction that we need to flesh out. Put some I think it's going to require a creative person to spend an hour to write some text on the rest of us to just deal with it. We had a discussion about a lot of terminology, a lot of it's mostly done, but we still have a number of issues open there. One of the pull requests is on the layered approach to attestation. So you see that in things like secure boot and things like that. And that's really just to give it some terminology and get it into the architecture. And we have a meeting tomorrow. That'll be our last meeting before the draft deadline. So we aim to basically get as much as possible done this week and to publish the O2 before the deadline. I think that we may be in a position to discuss working group last call at that point. And that's about it.
Sounds great. So you're saying review what's on the GitHub now,
yeah,
before publishing -2? Is that what you're saying?
I'm saying to the working group who's not part of the thing, your input now would be better than after the draft deadline.
Got it.
That's the critical thing. If you read it next week and have comments, well, then obviously they are welcome. It would be best to have large objections visible now rather than later.
And you would like those filed as issues?
You can file them as issues. You can, Lawrence, you come to the meeting, so you know you can bring them up. Any way is acceptable. Emails, any way you like. Issues, if they're very succinct. Issues to connect to if you have something bigger to say, then maybe sometimes it doesn't fit into two paragraphs. It's all for me.
Sounds good. can echo that too on the mail list, Michael. Sorry.
I will do that.
Thanks. Lawrence, you're up next.
All right, let me see if I figure out my sharing here. All right, can you see that? Okay. So I've been focusing on the claims that are in the current document and trying to get them closed out and some of the issues knocked off and the pull requests closed out. So the ones that are there, the claims that are in the current document, rather than going off onto the newer, bigger, interesting claims like COSWID and the public key. So just still focusing on the sort of initial set of claims. So the debug state claim, there's a pull request for it. I'd like to merge it. The last thing about it was what absence of the claim means. CWT doesn't say anything about this, but I think it kind of has to be that absence of a claim means it's not reported, which could be for a number of reasons, just not implemented, not known, provided in a proprietary value. So debug state is kind of right now at these five values. It's an enumerated type. You can see the CDL on the left. So I added some text to the EAT draft that I shared on the mailing list. It basically says that absence of a claim just means it's not reported. There is no such thing as a default value, because if there were default values, then everybody would have to know about every claim and it would be kind of a big mess. So I'd like to merge this. Of course, that's not the final word on that until we get to last call and all that. Two things about the merge here. One is I'd actually like to split boot state apart from debug state. So it has these combined in an array, but I'd like to split them because I think they're better separate. And when I was writing the code for this, it was probably going to be easier to write if they were separate. Any comments on merging? Everybody okay with merging with the split boot state from debug state?
Hey, Lawrence, this is Gary. I think we should, basically from my own perspective. So as far as debug state is concerned, it might be more expedient for us to just survey the relevant OTP bits and send that as an additional claim. View the right bits and send them as a relevant claim, because we're right now not finding a clean map into these claims here. So as long as if we merge this, we can contemplate vendors doing something like that. Fairly readily without being in violation of the spec, I think it's okay.
Vendors can always do boot and debug state in a proprietary way. That's always allowed. This claim becomes much less useful if everybody does it in a proprietary way. And that's really the last point here. I'm still looking for feedback on actual use and like why you can't use this. PSA kind of seems to have the same issue. So I guess my thinking is merge it so it's out there, and then, you know, continue some discussion.
Yeah, I think the only way you're going to move forward is to just push the issue, meaning go ahead and merge it. And that's a good way to get feedback.
Okay. All right. Well, keep driving that way. So I'm going to keep going here to not waste any time. So from some discussions of the hackathon and other things, I'd actually like to propose making EAT an update of RFC 8932. You know, thus far we've just been referencing it. The reasons for making it an update is one, to add guidance on designing claims. There was a lot of discussion around the Montreal 2019 timeframe about you know, how claims should be designed. A lot of people had a lot of opinions. So I captured a lot of that in a section called Claims Characteristics. Ned pointed it out that it's kind of dumb to discuss the characteristics of claims you've actually put in the standard already as if you were not putting them in yet. So I think that guidance then actually belongs in guidance of adding claims to the CWT registry. So therefore you get to the point that this is the EAT would actually be an update of CWT and giving additional guidance on claims design. Another reason to make it an update is that CWT allows floating point CBOR for dates. This seems like a real problem. It's entirely unnecessary. It gives no, you know, we don't care about fractional seconds of dates or anything in CWT. That would be really unusual. And it requires implementers to support floating point, which all hardware, software, and compilers don't necessarily all support that. So that's kind of a burden that I think a change that should be pulled out. And I discussed this with Karsten briefly, and he seemed in support of it. Another reason.
You would update 8392's IANA considerations or more of the document?
More. I should say 83. I mean, so it would be IANA considerations. We have to disallow floating point. That's another a separate update.
This is Hank. Maybe you can add something to this. There's an independent conflict with JWT at the moment and how 8707 and 7662 conflict on the OAuth list. And basically, if you look at it really closely, CWT will inherit that conflict because it inherits all the claims. It doesn't define them itself. And it just inherits them from JWT. So maybe some tinkering with CWT is in order in any way, and that might justify Lawrence's plan even more.
I'll wait till you finish the slide, I guess, but I do have comments on this.
Yeah. So then the last one was folks in the GP world would like to have unsigned tokens. That's really not allowed by CWT. Well, it's almost allowed because you can refer to one of the data structures, the data structure that's to be signed. But I don't think you can tag it with a CBOR tag to indicate it's a token. So I probably can't quite use it in the right way. And those were my three reasons. And I suspect that there are going to be others. It seems like CWT was done a little bit quickly, or I don't know, maybe didn't have as much implementation depth around it. And now that we're digging into it a little bit more, I think it seems like we're going to find a few things here. So there's a pull request that does has this additional guidance, and it indicates it's an update. If there's consensus here, I'd be up for merging that.
So this is Dave. I agree with most of the slide, but I'm going to have a I'm leaning towards objecting to the title. In other words, I agree with updating 8392. What I'm going to propose instead is that you split the document into two parts. One is EAT, and another one is updates to 8392. And the updates to 8392 shouldn't be in the RATS group. It should be in the group that defines CWT. But I agree with all the points that you made that should be done, but I believe it should be done in a separate document by a separate working group.
So you know, you mean split the document into two, not just into two parts.
Right, because CWTs aren't just used for attestation, right? This group should cover the attestation parts, right, like was on the previous slide and so on. And everything on this slide is not really specific to attestation in any way, and so that's why it should be in a different working group. But I fully support all the bullets on points on the slide. These are all good things. And so in that sense, I think we should not merge the pull request.
Yeah, okay. Any other comments?
I'm afraid Dave is right.
Yeah, I can see that.
That's left, Lawrence.
Yeah, but I'm done, so.
Perfect.
Well, nice to be done.
Not seeing your full deck. I wasn't sure whether you had more.
No, that was all I emailed about. That's it.
This is Hank. I will steal just another 20 seconds. Lawrence said that there's the structure inside the CWT that is not signed, that is also not tagged, therefore, and this thing is called the CWT claims set, and we could create a tag for that, which would be basically the unendorsed E that usually we'll talk about in, I don't know, a few minutes, I assume.
Yeah. But that would be in the CWT update document, not in the EAT document.
Yes, correct.
Okay, I'll look at the splitting the documents and all that. I may need a little help on procedural how to engage there, but
sure, no problem.
Okay, I'm done.
Excellent. Wow. We're making a record here. We're actually on time. Gary, I think you're next.
Yeah, can you hear me? Yes. Okay. Okay, I'm assuming my meeting window is being shared now?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right. And unendorsed tokens is coming up, correct?
It's still gray, but let's try. I think you're sharing your whole screen, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Before you went full screen, we could see the slide in a window, but when you went full screen, okay. It's now completely gray. No, we see nothing.
Yeah. Okay, so let me do this. I don't need to be sharing full screen anyway, so. Is it coming up? Is my meeting window coming up now?
It's funny, we can see your WebEx window.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so I know what to do. All right. It's fine. Okay, now is it coming in? Whoa. Still gray?
Still gray. Not,
right. Yeah. You need to okay. Take the you're being censored. WebEx is trying to avoid showing other windows. You really have to pick the application that you want to show. Okay.
Okay, it's not okay now. I think that's okay. How about this?
I see. Oh, now we got it.
Okay. Let's get started. I've already lost 2 minutes of my 15-minute allocation, so I'll try to get.
That's okay. I can give you a little bit of time back.
Okay. So, actually, let me give you a background. So, Lawrence introduced this topic of unendorsed tokens. my colleagues internally at Qualcomm, John Hilling and Jeremy O'Donoghue, and who you guys may be familiar with from Global Platform and TEEP participation, actually raised this issue that's come up in Global Platform, which is the topic of unendorsed tokens. I'll introduce this here. I think some people have already considered this in this group. So just to set the stage for where unendorsed tokens come into play, I refer to what at that time, you know, I created this slide deck a couple weeks ago. What at that time was the stable version of the architecture spec, and I'm leveraging this terminology here, where a couple of things is the attestation result, which from what I understand is typically what the verifier provides downstream after receiving attestation. The attester who would actually create the attestation result, and usually an attester will provide an endorsement, which is something that, and which is basically cryptographically verifiable, and the verifier, it's usually, and the verifier can, and the verifier has some evidence within the data itself that it's on the provenance.
I think you just said something about the attester providing the endorsement, and that's not the case.
Well,
the endorser provides the endorsement.
Yeah, I understand, but I would have thought that the endorser and the attester are one of the same most practical implementations.
That's not how the architecture is defined, no.
Okay.
Those are two completely separate roles.
Okay, but they're all reside within the same device, potentially?
No, typically they're not. So, for example, yeah, in Intel's case, the endorser is an Intel server.
Ah, okay. But an endorser is the one that so an endorser actually does the cryptographic operation, right? So I don't know how you said
to the extent that an endorsement itself includes a cryptographic operation to create it, then yes.
Yeah. So I don't know. At least on an IoT device or a mobile device, I don't know how you separate the two. But I mean, they could be functionally separate inside while running in the device.
Right now there's no. Oh, go ahead, Hank.
Yeah, so it is typically not residing on the IoT devices. It is exactly in the upper bureaucracy, which is the trust anchor or the supply chain, and those are the endorsers.
We did not have any case where the architecture implied that endorser could ever be on an IoT device. Until we started introducing that discussion and that concept in our discussions around a composite device. But other than that, the endorser is always something that's like whatever the manufacturer runs.
That's a pity because that's not real. That's not reality. But anyway, we can.
I don't know about your use cases, but it's absolutely reality in the use cases that I know of.
Yeah, but it's not real. Let's get on this for a second because an IoT device that we provide today has a root of trust. The root of trust will provide the endorsement. The root of trust will actually. I'm telling you what we produce. Dad, you're arguing with me. I'm telling you what we provide.
All right. Let me ask a question then. In your root of trust, mm-hmm. does the root of trust provide a statement that says it was, you know, Qualcomm manufactured and signed by a manufacturer key that the root of trust does not have?
Why would it? So you're saying that it would be signed by the manufacturer key, ideally. So that would.
It is possible for a device to provide a cached endorsement that was supplied at manufacturing time, but the endorsement is signed by a key that the device doesn't have. It's signed by, you know, Qualcomm that says, you know, this is an authentic Qualcomm root of trust.
Yeah, but it does have a key. We've securely provisioned it. I put that in the security considerations of the document.
Yeah, it has its own key, but its own key is not what signs the endorsement.
Why?
The manufacturer's key is what signs the endorsement, right?
Okay. Okay, that's fine. Not, I can
that's a definition of endorsement, right?
Yeah, I can tell you that I can tell you this, that we're not going that out of state, that an EAT token returned from any of our devices would not be signed by an entity outside of the device. So that's
and that is typical. That just means that if you want to know that that thing is really, really, really a Qualcomm chip, then you couldn't get that from the chip because it doesn't carry the Qualcomm signature. It's only signed by the chip itself.
Yeah. So when I'm talking about it, so you're saying that would not be an endorsement in the RATS architecture.
Correct. And that's why in the architecture document, often you get the attestation, sorry, you get the evidence from the attester that does not include the endorsement. And then separately, you get an endorsement statement that says, yeah, this really is a Qualcomm chip as opposed to some knockoff.
Yeah, I was confused about this too until the hackathon. I mean, the way I think of an endorsement is that are, you know, claims that come from outside the device that are sort of secured out of band. So they could be really simple or they could be really involved. You know, an endorsement just could say, the simplest endorsement is you can believe everything this device says. The most complex endorsement is, you know, here's the full claim set for this device, and you're not going to get really where all the claims are implied. So at least that's my current name endorsement,
yeah.
And that was really helpful for me to understand. That made a big difference, and because I used to think the endorsement was the verification key, and that's certainly not that's definitely not wrong.
Yeah, that's fine, but I mean, we're not many IoT devices are not going to have an external endorser of the attestation results that they provide, right? So okay, no, that's fine. That's clearly not what I'm talking about here.
Yeah, I think you're talking about unsigned tokens, right?
Yeah. So let's continue on. And Lawrence, I think that's also the you know, that's what we need to clarify as well on the EAT document if we ever add this in there. So we have attestation results, which is really what I'm concerned with. Evidence is signed by the device. Attestation results are signed by a verifier. So evidence is signed by the device. Attestation results are signed by a verifier. This I understand. Okay. Lack of endorsements can also be considered in the execution of the appraisal policy. Now, remember, when I'm talking about endorsements here, I'm talking about I'm not talking now about the architecture anymore. I'm talking about an unsigned token. So let's go ahead and just keep that in mind. So here I'm saying that there are trusted paths, what I'm calling trusted paths, where between an attester and a verifier, or an attester and a relying party, or even from a verifier to a relying party, I'm showing the passport model here. If there's a trusted path, which is anchored by potentially a root of trust on both sides of the path, then cryptographic verification of the token itself may not be necessary. So I'm showing you the password model where I'm saying, okay, you can have a mutually authenticated transport path. And based on the appraisal policy, the way I understand the architecture document, the appraisal policy can actually take that into account too and say, okay, yes, if the verifier is executing the appraisal policy, it can say, it can actually take that into account saying, yes, I have an unsigned token received from the attester, but it's over a trusted path, and the trusted path is we probably need a better definition of it. I have one in my mind, but I don't know. But I think it would be nice to get that into the architecture document.
So if I understand right, it's actually implicitly signed because the it sends across a session where that session is encrypted. Or sorry, at least signed, the session itself is signed. And so the unsigned token is being sent inside something that is signed. And so in that case, the sign is sort of transitive, and I would say it's implicitly signed. It's not explicitly signed.
Yes. Yes, that's a good way of thinking of it. And you can have, and even with the background check, you have a, you know, you have similar considerations in the communication between the attester and the RP and the verifier and the RP. So, okay, replacing your mind unendorsed with unsigned, does CWT allow
it? I'm going to replace it with implicitly signed.
Implicitly signed, fantastic. And we can, and we got another thing to potentially augment the terminology in the architecture document. Thank you, Dave.
I saw Thomas put in chat, yes, implicitly signed.
Yeah, okay.
Is that, so let's retain this kind of evidence long-term. Yeah, I agree, Thomas.
Yeah, whoever's taking the notes, please put that in there. Put that in the notes so we have a common common terminology. RFC, so does CWT allow for this? RFC 8392 seems to allow it. It gives the option, it says the CWT is signed, mapped, or encrypted, but you know, which kind of is terminology that, in my opinion, would say, okay, it doesn't have to be it doesn't have to be any of those. So, but the problem is RFC 8392 also require also mentions that the we have to prefix with the COSE CBOR tag, and the COSE spec RFC 8152. Actually defines two constructs, the COSE object and the message type. Now, the COSE object is a collection of protected headers, unprotected headers, and message content. Okay, there's nothing really in there about any kind of any signing, encryption, etc. The message types, however, actually do not contemplate currently an unsigned token. Unsigned, unencrypted token. And it's not clear what RFC 8152's message is, recommendation is for these for unsigned tokens. So, and so why send one? Even if the path is trusted, there are a couple of reasons. Some resource-limited devices may want to avoid exercising their crypto engines when it's not absolutely required by the policy. So there's a trusted path already established. And if the attester knows about the appraisal policy, where the appraisal policy can take that into account, they may, and then they just say, okay, leave the crypto engine alone. Some transport paths may be trusted and throughput limited. And this is actually the example cited by my colleagues in GP, was narrowband IoT, where the data rate is rather small. And the crypto overhead can be it can be costly when considered in mind of that. So, why do we care? Well, we'd like an interoperable solution for implicitly trusted tokens, and we'd still like to leverage existing standardized formats. And we don't want to, in my opinion, we don't want to avoid the developing custom protocols based on the attestation payload. So we considered, okay, can we send the ETH payload as a CBOR object as an example? I think that that's going to lead us down some paths where we're actually getting into defining protocols that we may not want to define. How we have to say, be very explicit as to what the CBOR object is and how it would be distinguished from other CBOR objects. And it may not be a path that we want to go down. So, but I mean, it's something we can consider. But some options to consider are extend architecture spec to address how we do it, how we deal with implicitly trusted tokens. I believe that's what we said. Some other ones, these are not all, and I said these aren't all mutually exclusive. COSE, a new COSE message type, which I think in the previous discussion we had, Lawrence, we were discussing some things that probably need to be done in collaboration with the corresponding working group, and this would be one of them. We could do the CBOR route and define a CBOR tag for the attestation payload. Another thing we considered internally was extending the COSE algorithm registry with a mode that can be leveraged for unsigned tokens. Such as a zero-link MAC or hash. One thing I think I've concluded is we cannot do nothing and just assume that all implementers where they see, for instance, a missing message type will react the same way. I did look through some open source COSE implementations, and none of them have really good fall down. Sorry, none of them really really have any good handling for when, for instance, a COSE message type is missing, or when it's not part of the registry. So I think we really can't avoid doing anything we want to support this use case. So our recommendation were two things. The architecture team defines recommended practices for implicitly trusted tokens. And we work with the COSE working group to define a unendorsed COSE message. We can call it we should probably call it an unsigned, unencrypted message to be more explicit on this. That way we don't step on what endorsement has been defined in the architecture team. That's it. That's my presentation. Any questions?
I wonder, just relating to the conversation we had at the end of Lawrence's about splitting the document and having a updating document that goes back to the other working group, I wonder if this could be combined into that same effort and covered in that same draft once it's split.
Yeah, I think so. I agree. The one thing I don't want to do is extend the COSE algorithm registry without working with the COSE working group, because that's... I think we would have to do that there.
Yeah, I started forming my opinion a couple slides back when you talked about, well, how would I actually encode the notion that it's neither encrypted nor assigned? And that sounds like it's I couldn't figure it out from reading the document. It was one before that, I think it was. But oh yeah, actually, it's the bottom half of this slide. Right, the bottom half of this slide was the one that made me think, yes, this is probably something that should be covered in that same document. Although this is in reference to a different RFC, so that's the only thing that I'm not quite sure about, because I think CWTs were done in the ACE working group, not the COSE working group, and so that's why I'm kind of asking it as a question, because maybe it's not right. Maybe those are two different things. I'm not sure. I need somebody that's part of ACE and COSE to tell me.
They're done in ACE.
Yeah, this seems like we should start with just an unsigned token in the ACE. I mean, it doesn't seem like creating a new COSE unsigned message type doesn't seem like the best thing to me.
So that's what that's my question. Maybe Lawrence, if you have an opinion, do you think that the bottom half of this is best covered in the same type of stuff as what you were showing in your updating CWT?
Yeah, and this was actually the use case that I was thinking of when I mentioned that, just because I'd heard rumor of it. I didn't know the details until now.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah. We need to move on. So,
So this is just to start a discussion. But I'm just giving some recommendations. But
I think you've provided some good recommendations, Gary. My recommendation to you is to echo this again in the mail group, because not everybody could attend this call.
Okay.
Just to give you and also bring it up in the ACE in the ACE working group.
Okay. All right. Okay, thank you.
Yep. Thanks. Okay, Eric. We have 9 minutes.
I'll give an overview. Are you able to see the screen, or is it doing the wrong screen?
Nope. Good. Fine.
All right. Okay. So thanks, Nancy. I posted a new draft at the end of last week. This draft was driven by a number of things. First, I've been attending some of the architecture team discussions. I'll be getting into composite evidence and passports. And I wanted to bring a number of things together that I've seen elsewhere in the working group. Those things include Guy and Jessica's draft on the overall context for attestation as it would be in routed networks. I think that this is following that, as I'll mention. We've had Frank's draft on pub-sub models. We've had the Yang data model. What I tried to do was come up with a use case which kind of pulls those contexts together. And this draft is intended to talk about a use case I'll bring up, and then try to identify the gaps in technology and maybe some of the gaps in terminology, just to be able to make sure we have everything covered. And the goal is really to go over the use case today, as well as some of the types of technologies that might be relevant in this use case, and then hopefully continue the discussions on the mailing list. So the use case is something that I've called trusted path routing. Basically, we have integrity being determined of individual routers or switches. And what happens if you want to have a trusted path through the network, which only goes across devices that have the highest levels of integrity? Why would you want that? Like finance, military, government, these all might be interesting things to want to traverse only the devices that have the highest levels of integrity. There's two kind of models that were put into the draft. The first one is a centralized model where you take a stream of evidence up from a router or switch, take it up to a verifier, and then a verifier also acts as a network controller, and it can go ahead and push paths down to edge devices to make sure that traffic to subnets of those customers only traverse devices that are highly secured and trustworthy. The other method was distributed, where instead of the verifier and the controller provisioning the edge devices, they return a passport down to a router, and that passport is passed to other peers of the router, and then the peers go ahead and add the links where the passport came on in order to build a trusted topology, which only includes links to trusted devices. And the idea here is that if your passport is good, then you add the link to the topology that is a trusted topology. And so the question then comes, what kind of technologies would we need for that kind of model? Well, the draft goes through three, and obviously we can't go through them right now in depth, but I'm going to highlight them. The first one is the attestation event stream. The idea of streaming evidence from a router up to a verifier, router or tester to a verifier, is something which matches to the Yang model that is already adopted by the working group, as well as a combination with the Yang subscription models, which Frank also mentioned in his draft. That's RFC 8639. Basically, we get Yang notifications. Those Yang notifications include evidence of PCRs being extended in TPMs, as well as the latest values of the measurements coming off the TPMs. There are a number of other things we could go into, but basically just think it being an official way of defining the evidence off of a router. The second element of the draft is trustworthiness levels, and I expect this is going to get very interesting over time, but eventually we're going to have to talk about what do we mean by trustworthy in some measured and quantifiable way. In the architecture team, there were comments such as, is it binary? Is it not binary? Well, we do know that it probably is going to be a little bit more than binary. So how do we identify what trustworthiness means when returned in a network passport? Eventually, I think this has to match into stuff like what's in draft Fedorka that goes ahead and identifies what's in different PCRs. But I think that we're a long way of standardizing what that might be. But we should recognize that we need methods of identifying trustworthiness in the model. The last element really is the main reason I got started on the draft, which is the composite evidence passport. There was some mails on this about a month ago, I think. But basically, what does a passport need to have in that central and the distributed model? Well, it turns out that we can go ahead and take the streaming evidence from an attester, go up to a verifier, sign the results of the verifier, correlate them back on the attester, and the attester taking TPM quotes from the first request at one, another TPM quote when a nonce comes from a lying party, and the results from the verifier can, without creating any new evidence, aggregate together various bits of information which can be taken to the relying party and that can be used to determine whether that attester is trusted or not. Again, there's a lot of moving parts here, so I'm hoping that we can have some discussions on the mailing list, but this is what I'm hoping to use as the did I get the terminology right from the architecture discussions, say, is this what passport means? And is this what composite evidence means? And if not, maybe make sure that we that we agree on the terminology to be used. I'll adapt whatever's good, but whatever terminology needs to cover a use case like this within the network. So that's the real fast view. I think I've used a lot less than 10 minutes, but that's the overall context. If there's a question or two, great. If not, we have the mailing list, and that's that.
So I have a comment here on the notion of trustworthiness. My view is trustworthiness is kind of in the eye of the beholder. It's the relying party that decides what's trustworthy and what's not. Trustworthiness in attestation is really broad range, and you're introducing this idea of trustworthiness to route traffic. That's very, very different from trustworthiness of for a financial transaction, or trustworthiness for authentication, or trustworthiness for access to documents. So I think defining some sort of a notion of trustworthiness to route in the routing care context is fine, but I would think it needs to be qualified as trustworthiness for routers, not
agreed.
General.
Agreed. Again, in here, in this picture, you can see the verifier is a trustworthiness level as known by a verifier. Certainly the relying party is not just going to accept that. And in the draft, you can see how to derive its own decision from multiple bits of evidence. So I do agree that we're only talking routers, and I do agree that the trustworthiness level asserted by the verifier is only one bit of the picture that the relying party has to use.
Yeah, so just to, in this presentation, qualify it.
Fair enough, yep.
So you're sticking to the router domain, and call it router trustworthiness RT or something like that. That's all.
Fair enough. Yep.
Yeah. So it's Guy speaking. I think what Eric is suggesting is just that there's another claim that can be made that
right
the device thinks it is qualified at a certain level of trustworthiness, and it's up to the guy on the other end to decide whether he believes it or not, but at least there's a claim for it.
Well, I get really scared when we use the term trustworthiness in a broad general way, because marketing people use that and all that. So that's
define the term a little more closely. That would be good.
Yeah. So Eric, I think in your draft you do scope it in terms of routing. So
correct.
My suggestion is I think it'd be good if you presented it again at the face-to-face and just make that clarification.
Can do.
Okay. So with that, we are out of time. So I can take a quick 30 seconds to ask if there's anything else. Otherwise, do let us, the RATS chairs, know agenda items. So for those that want to present, let us know your agenda. I know some of you expressed concerns about the Monday and Friday. So if you're only going to be there for one of the sessions, just let us know as well. And we'll try to accommodate. Other than that, I think we're done.
Nancy, I will try to be there for both, but do you expect to be able to say what topics will be on which days?
Well, it depends on who all wants to present what times. And usually I try to categorize them to a natural flow.
Yeah.
But I understand if people aren't going to be there for the whole week, right?
Yeah.
We might have to make some adjustments for that.
Okay. So we should get our request for time slots in.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Put me down. Thanks.
All right. Thanks, yeah. And then also let me know how much time you think you'll need.
Yep.
All right. Yeah. And a lot of people will be remote, so we'll have to figure out what we do to adjust for that. And I just found out during this call, I will also be remote.
Well, I may end up being remote.
I think we should probably plan for an all remote. And I'd like to quickly throw in a proposal that we have an in formal, but scheduled like an interim meeting for just discussions where people can say what problems they're having, to substitute for hallway conversations that would have happened. So maybe the chairs, we can confer on that and come up with some kind of a plan, because that's one of the big things people will miss from in person. So I'd like to figure out how we can facilitate that, and at least, you know, the session that you just had, the hackathon, was really helpful to aid in that progress and those hallway conversations. So thank you very much for that.
More on that soon.
For what it's worth, we missed you, Nancy, Ned, and Kathleen at the hackathon.
I'm not a programmer, so.
Well, you.
But thank you.
You had 2 days.
What was that?
You had 2 days there.
You could have learned. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, I can program. I just, you know, I'm rusty.
Well, you know, there are other ways that you can contribute, because I was contributing. I'd like to think I was contributing to the tea hackathon at the last face-to-face, wherever it was that we were, Singapore.
Yeah, lots of different ways to contribute, and we probably also need to find out whether we could do some remote participation at the hackathon, a little bit more aggressive remote participation, as it seems.
That would be great to figure out how we could do that. So if people want to brainstorm on, you know, how we could do a remote hackathon, you know, how do we collaborate? How do we have open channels of discussion? You know, how do we progress that? And we'll fumble a little, but then make it better from, you know, what we learned from fumbling.
I like that idea.
Cool. Well, I'm thinking people like you, Hannes, will be big contributors to shaping it.
Yeah, I can start an email discussion.
Okay. All right. And yeah. I'll make sure I provide a positive outlook on it, because I think that makes a big difference.
Thanks. Definitely. Thanks. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you, everyone.
Bye. Bye.